I'm one of the co-founders and co-directors of Climate Health Now here in my backyard with Amanda Milstein.
Excellent. I'm also a co-founder and co-director of Climate Health Now. Sitting in Ashley's backyard where it's not a million degrees.
Where it's not a million degrees. I'm like
literally like over 100 degrees on this day.
So
I think
we're echoing. Let me make that echo. Hold on.
I'm getting a lot of feedback from
YouTube
being too close or having two microphones open or something.
Is that better?
Yeah, I think so.
Sorry.
Okay. Thank you for that. Great. So we're going to jump in to our final sharing of all the work that many of you have been a part of with Building for Mission and the what's come out of that in terms of our structure and strategy.
Awesome. All righty. So thank you all for being here. First of all, I don't know. I think we're going to keep admitting people as we go. We had hoped to hear, why don't we just have everybody come off mute and say hi real quick? Because there's not a ton of us. If this is your first time, I don't know if this is anyone's first CHN meeting ever.
Maybe Pam Lee?
Oh, Dan. Yeah. Do you want to just say hi and where you are and what you do?
Yeah, sure. This is Pam speaking. I've been on some other Climate Health Now meetings, but I don't think I've actually made it to a like community meeting like this. So I'm really excited. I'm an infectious disease specialist and I'm based out of Los Angeles.
Awesome. Glad you're here. So we can just go around 15 seconds popcorning so I can go ahead and call in folks to go forward. How about Noma?
Oh, let's see. Can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yes. Sorry, I'm my camera's off. I'm doubling this as my lunch hour and you guys don't want to see that. But my name is Noma Ojiako. I'm an OBGYN here in Sacramento. Were we supposed to say anything else? I kind of missed the portion of it. Okay. Perfect. All right, nice to meet you guys again.
Glad you're here. How about Kelly? Kelly, where are you calling in from and what your day job is?
Oh, hi, sorry, my Wi-Fi went away. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. Hi, nice to meet you. My name is Kelly Henderson. I'm a UX researcher with a background in public health and health psychology. I live in Washington, D.C., and I'm currently on the rooftop of MLK Library in Washington, D.C.
Amazing.
Cool.
Yeah.
Special guest. Welcome. Yeah. How about we'll go to, I see Angelina.
I literally just stuck food in my mouth.
Okay.
I don't want to choke.
We can come back to you. Yeah, we'll do that. Brenda?
I think I just heard my name. Did you say me?
You sure did. Yeah.
Where are you calling in? I also am doing the Zoom eating thing, so I'm going to spare you my lunch as well. My name is Brenda Nguyen. She, her. I am an ophthalmologist in Santa Monica, so based in the LA area, and nice to see everybody here.
Glad you're here. Angelina, coming to you.
All right. Yeah. So I'm Angelina Kranz-Yoon. I'm an allergist in Davis and in Davis and Woodland. So.
Great. Glad that you're here. And Cecilia.
I have a leaky burrito that I have to deal with. Cecilia, anesthesia, critical care. I'm in Los Altos. I practice at Stanford and Washington Hospital in Fremont.
Great, glad you're here. And we totally understand the lunch hour.
Yeah. And you, just so we state it, you can be on video and eating. Yeah. I totally understand if you don't want to be, but no fear about doing so.
The lunch meeting.
Yeah.
And I'm going alphabetically. Cindy.
Hi, I'm Cindy Haig. I'm a midwife and I work at a birth center, Pacifica Family Maternity Center in Berkeley, and I am eating on Zoom. So thank you for bearing with me.
Bon appetit. Dan, we're coming your way.
You say Dan? All right. Yeah. Great. Hi, everyone. Nice to join you. Dan Wu. I use he, him pronouns. I work at the California Department of Public Health. I serve as a team lead for their climate change and health equity section, joining from Sacramento today.
Woo-hoo. Glad you're here. And then okay. Or Karen?
Hi, I'm Karen Duderstadt. I'm a nurse practitioner in pediatrics, and I retired recently from UCSF School of Nursing and San Francisco General. I'm also working with the California Nurses for Environmental Health and Justice, which is a newer environmental group for NPs and nurses in California.
Great, glad you're here. And then I see Jeff Mann.
Hello, hi, I'm Jeff Mann. I'm an orthopedic surgeon. I work in Oakland and Berkeley.
Welcome. Welcome back. Jeff is one of our earliest members. Glad you're here. And then we'll go to Hina next.
Hi, can you see me?
Yeah, welcome.
Okay. Hi, I'm Hina Fuller. I'm a psychiatrist. I work in Walnut Creek in Mindful Health Solutions. I have attended a few meetings before, but very irregular.
Okay.
Sorry.
Happy to have you here.
Glad you're back.
Thank you. Thanks.
Then we'll go to Mike Martin.
Yeah, Mike Martin, internal medicine and preventive medicine here in San Francisco on the clinical faculty at UCSF. And glad to be here. He, him.
Great. Thank you. One of our ally orgs is the PSR, so we're glad you're here. And then we went to Noma, Pam, Shuin.
Hi, I didn't realize you were going to skip so many letters. hi, I'm Shuin. I go by she, her, and I'm a family nurse practitioner in Los Angeles.
Awesome. Did everybody get to introduce themselves, or did anybody not get to introduce themselves? Cool. We're glad y'all are here. Okay, this is you.
All righty. So thank you all for being here today. This is an exciting meeting. There's a lot that has gone into it. I think I'm feeling equally parts nervous, excited, and the buildup of momentum. And I think I can certainly speak for myself. I imagine for a lot of us as well, the heat wave that we all experienced and now these fires is making the urgency of this work feel all the more present. There's nothing else I would rather be doing right now than thinking about how we can help. So the goals for today's meeting are really twofold. And as Ashley mentioned at the beginning, where we're coming from is really nearly 3 years of work, and then more consolidated within that, the last six months or so, we've been working with Building for Mission, who many of you have had the opportunity to meet with. They're the two consultants in particular who we've been working with, and through focus groups and one-on-ones and listening sessions and really a lot of deep work with them and with many of the people on this call. Thinking very critically about what work needs to be done, where CHN could play a role, and how we want to get there. So what we're hoping that you all will come away with a clear sense of from today is a sense of strategy, which is really how we're going to use the resources we have to bring about the change we want to see in California, and a clear sense of the organizational structure we're building in order to achieve our strategy. And really what we're hoping is to really set some early steps as well for people thinking about the place that they or the role that they'd like to play within this structure.
And by this, you mean you.
Yes. Yes.
And a big warm welcome to Pedja, who is joining us from the Boston area or Spain. Do you want to say hi, Pedja?
Joining from Boston this time, and it's good to be here. Yeah.
So. Great. A treasured mentor. We're glad you're here. So we always re-anchor in our mission, and it's been clarified through the building for mission process and our listening sessions with many of you, our members. So just to clarify again, our North Star is that we are a group of members of the California health community who advocate for climate action through a health and equity framework. We use community organizing to build the base of climate engaged health, allied health, and healthcare administrator professionals across California to leverage our trusted health voices in support of climate justice movement in order to protect health and achieve health equity. So that's what we're all about. And everything you're gonna hear going forward is really to help achieve that. So I didn't really understand what organizing was like 3 years ago. I knew that Barack Obama was one and he's pretty awesome. And, you know, Cesar Chavez, folks like that. But I've learned a lot in the past few years, including, as many of you have heard me say, I took a literally life-changing class with Marshall Gans, a living legend community organizer, last year. So community organizing is really about building people power and using people who share values and share, you know, similar concerns to invest in each other as leaders in our community in a snowflake model. So you'll hear us talk about that all the time. And this is the snowflake. So this is where community organizers, that's me and Amanda and our expanding transitional leadership team. You're gonna hear from two of our incoming transitional leadership team members today, Noma and Shuin. So the organizers kind of are at the middle, and really this is about investing in each other in order to develop the leadership potential in all of us that we all have in order to recruit more people and more people to scale to address, you know, the problem that we share. So in brief, you know, the idea of community organizing is that we engage a body of people. The lingo for that is constituency. So you are our constituency, which is California's health community. And we care about a particular issue, obviously climate change and health equity. And what we're working on is increasing our influence on solutions for that issue. And in our particular form, that's policy advocacy, by organizing them towards one common goal. And I'll show you a visual of that shortly. So that's in general what community organizing is all about. And, you know, CHN's particular style is that we are engaging, like I said, the health community in California, folks who care about climate and health and equity, in order to increase our capacity to advance policy level climate action. So that's what we're all about. And the strategy, the what level of change we're working on through lots of listening sessions with all of you and mentors, is we're working on state level advocacy. So there's a lot of important work to be done, you know, in our cities, in our counties, but we are zeroing in on state level climate advocacy for the near future, because this is our map. This is what we're laser focused on. So that could include California legislation and or regulation. And our policy agenda is really the US call to action on climate, health, and equity that one of our other treasured mentors, Linda Rudolph, was a big part of bringing about, which has, you know, the support of the CMA, the AMA, lots of different health orgs. And we're doing that through building our member base. That's our people power. That's our members through community organizing. And we'll talk more about this, but just to name, you know, two of the ways that we're building that base and recruiting more members and empowering our members is through something called resource teams. And so we'll have two. And this is through feedback from all of our members and our work with the consultants building for mission. One is going to be called, you know, CHN Speaks, which is a lot about storytelling, educational activities, and that's to recruit more members and to, you know, help us to really articulate the importance of this as health professionals, health folks. And another one is going to be about decarbonizing the healthcare sector itself. We all know that, you know, the healthcare sector contributes roughly 10% or so of greenhouse gases to our economy. And so we have a lot of work to do internally. And so we're going to help our members learn about that also. And then I think my last slide in this section is about our theory of change. So again, this is something I didn't understand until relatively recently, but the theory of change is really how we use our resources in order to bring about the change that we want to see in the world. So our particular theory of change is that if we organize and enable California's health community to put pressure on policymakers and decision makers in collaboration and partnership with community-based environmental justice and youth organizations, then we will see bold, urgent system-level solutions because of the unique social trust and influence that our professions have on public opinion. And, you know, when many people are polled for the professions that they trust the most, it's always nurses first, and then doctors, and then pharmacists. And that's really what we're trying to add to the climate movement, is that leverage that our unique trust gives us. So another way to show this theory of change is, you know, the status quo of burning coal, oil, and gas to fuel our economies. That's what we're trying to change, right? So that's the mountain of oil and gas status quo. It's how I think about it. And what we're doing in CHN's work is we're bringing our shared dynamite. This is our tool, right? This is what we have to make social change. And it's that those trusted voices in a therapeutic, health protective way. But what we want to do is have all of our members bring our dynamite, that unique trust, to the same place on this mountain so that it's a concerted, a collective action that really does move the mountain of status quo. So this is hopefully a valuable way to visualize how we see the opportunity to bring about change. And this is, you know, again, this is health protecting, this is do no harm dynamite. And I'll pass it to Amanda.
Alrighty, so I'm going to walk us through, this is a slide many of you probably remember from the last strategy and structure update we presented, but walking through kind of piecing all of these different parts together. So our vision is that we are a community of health professionals, health workers, members of the California health community, who are diverse in race, ethnicity, gender, geographic location, type of health professional, who are organized. That is, go back one, which is a key part of this, is that we are all working collectively to bring our quote unquote dynamite on this important topics to policymakers and decision makers, and working in collaboration and partnership with groups that are on the ground, who are doing this work, who have firsthand knowledge of climate and health impacts of fossil fuels, that we're working in partnership and collaboration with those groups and adding our voices there to achieve bold, urgent, system-level climate solutions to protect health. So that's walking through all steps of our vision. I'm going to touch a bit more on who our members are, and a little bit on why and what we see as it meaning to be a CHN member going forward. So we are looking to build as big a tent as possible, right? We've talked about this before, but climate change is a daunting issue, to say the least, that affects all aspects of society, all aspects of community. And it is interrelated, obviously, with many of the structural, racist, like all of the many sort of structural ills that our societies face are in many ways all related to the issue of climate change. So one of the things that we are looking to do is to build a very large tent of the California, you know, that is the collective California health community, bringing our voices to the issues of climate health and equity. So really focusing on building that big tent. What we're asking CHN members to commit to, and there will be much more information about this forthcoming, but we're asking members to commit to representing and advancing Climate Health Now's principles, which we have shared previously and will continue to share, participating in CHN's work either via campaigns or contributing to teams, which we'll be getting into shortly, Participating in a virtual orientation, what we're sort of at this point calling the CHN 101, although it may get rebranded or renamed eventually, but participating at some point in the early parts of membership in a specific opportunity to learn about CHN and to really be onboarded in a meaningful way. And we're also going to have pay-as-you-can model dues in a way that we never have before, that will be on a sliding scale and not cost prohibitive in any way, but another way of building community and putting our resources toward good use. And we will, one of the things that we have been working on that will be coming out shortly is a membership pledge. So you can all look forward to seeing that. So I had just shared in the chat the link to a Google form that we're hoping people could fill out as we move through, that goes section by section. I think we're at this point now probably through section 3 on that. But then we also can open it up now. We got back on schedule here. So we have about 5 minutes for discussion, questions, comments. Feel free or to work on the Google form.
Yeah. And the Google form is really to capture like a little bit more depth of your feedback than we're able to kind of in this format. So we will definitely study that and look into it. But I also wanted to say hi to Terry. I think you joined late. If you want to say hi and say where you're joining in from. And Lauren is just from. Oh, and Lauren too.
Hi, I'm Terry Weiss, and I'm from Los Angeles area. And I appreciate being here today and working on climate change with you.
Great, thank you. Glad you're here. And Lauren, do you want to say hi?
Sorry, I'm muted.
Oh, you're good, we can hear you.
Hello, nice to see everybody. Sorry to be late.
No worries. Do you want to just say, Lauren, where you are and what you do?
So I'm not new, and I am at Valley Medical Center. I'm an ear, nose, and throat surgeon, I've been working on trying to get our administration to engage with the HHS pledge. I've given some talks at our recent medical leadership conference, both at our hospital and at O'Connor Hospital, and I'm scheduled to give one at St. Louis Hospital as well, since we are in a 3-hospital enterprise. And it seems like, at least with initial feedback, there are going to be a number of physicians that are going to want to sign on to the letter.
Well, awesome. That's great progress. Yeah, that falls into our healthcare decarb resource team. So we want to continue to support that team, that work, and grow it. Did anybody have any trouble getting into the Google form? Y'all good with that? So any questions, clarifications so far on what we've shared? Because the rest of the meeting will really be about the structure for where we're going from here. And Noma is our chat monitor. So thank you thank you for monitoring. Yeah. Okay. I guess we'll just keep going. So yeah, we want this to be, interactive. So if you do have a question, just raise your Zoom hand and we will integrate your question. Okay, so now, let's see, get back on track here. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I like to kind of reframe this, that there's, a lot of architectural folks talk about how form follows function, and the, mission defines what our strategy is as CHN. And then that strategy is what defines our structure. So what we'll talk about going forward is how we're going to structure our community in order to achieve our strategy. So that's the second half of this hour. So this is a pretty, information rich slide, but this is the best way that we have so far for visualizing how we're gonna structure our members in CHN to be super effective and to scale and to bring in, you know, we'd like to have thousands of members in the next year or two. So the way I'm going to walk you through this, and then this is just a kind of an overview slide, and then we'll, Amanda and I will break down each part of each of these teams so that you know who's on it and then how they're contributing to our overall, you know, state level advocacy work. So starting with the people, it seems like it makes sense. So the people, you know, our members will be divided up into roughly 8-ish local hubs, and those hubs will be defined by geography. So, you know, we have a lot of folks in the East Bay, we have a Central Valley hub, we have a, you know, Capital Corridor and North State hub. So we'll build these slowly. We're going to start with a couple this year, but the hubs are geographically based. So folks who live close to each other. I'll go up to the statewide leadership team. That's going to be a team that determines what our members are working on and what our state level advocacy goals are. And the state level leadership team will have representation from our local teams, our local hubs, and as well as somebody from each of the resource teams. And the statewide leadership team is also going to get recommendations from an outside advocacy advisory team. And this is going to be not CHN members, but folks who are, you know, really immersed in California climate justice policies, environmental justice policies, health policy. So these are sort of the policy experts, because we're not trying to kind of become all experts ourselves. But what we're asking them to do is to tell our leadership team, these are the advocacy opportunities that CHN's voice as the health community of California can really move the needle on. And then our leadership team will decide from their recommendations, you know, maybe 3-ish campaigns that we will then put all of our eggs in those baskets. And that's what we will organize around for the year. And then the resource teams will kind of really help with the educational aspect of things, help, you know, like Lori was just talking about the HHS healthcare decarbonization pledge, things like that, that will fall under the healthcare decarbonization resource team, which is a lot about education for our members and sharing information. And then CHN Speaks, which Brenda has, by Kelly, which Brenda has a lot of interest in, is helping us to really be confident and you know, prepared to speak to our colleagues, to speak to the press, to speak to our patients and our communities about the health impacts of climate and what solutions we need to protect health. And then, and we'll go deeper into each of these again, we're also building towards having 3 CHN staff members in the next couple of years. And we really actually want to hire them next summer. So those 3 staff members will support all of the other teams in being really effective. And the CHN staff will have coaching from something that's sort of similar to a board, but isn't exactly that, because CHN is a 501. We have So we don't have to have a board to IRS. This advisory council will be sort of like a board role, but we'll really be coaching our staff to knock it out of the park. So this is the big, huge picture. And then we'll go into the details of each part.
Okay. So we're going to try to get a lot more granular. There's still, as you can tell just from the picture of or the organizational diagram alone, there's a lot of detail here, but we're going to try to answer these 3 basic questions for each part of the organization. So the first question is just who is on the team, or who is eligible to be on the team. The second question is, what does the team do? And the third question is, how does the team contribute to our overall strategic vision, which is statewide campaign related or legislative regulatory advocacy work? Okay, so we'll jump in so we're going to start by talking about the leadership team. And so there's 2 slides here. We're going to talk first about the sort of eventual leadership team, where we see this going, and then a bit about the transitional leadership team, which we're going to have for a year before we get to the point where we are having a representative statewide election. But the leadership team will be a statewide body that is eventually elected by members. And what this team is responsible for doing is many different things, but one of the main things is working with, working with the advocacy advisory team, who, as we talked about, are outside, who are policy, legislative, environmental justice community group advocates and experts in California legislation, that they'll be working with them to figure out what are the campaigns on which we are going to have CHN members engage. So the idea is that the advocacy advisory team will have recommendations for specific pieces of legislation, specific pieces or regulatory aspect or regulations in California where CHN could engage, and the leadership team will be responsible for determining, do we have the capacity as an organization to do that? Do we have, how much knowledge do we have of that? How much knowledge building will we need to do in order to really effectively participate and bring our voices to that work? Other responsibilities will include supporting the development of resource teams, local hubs, and ensuring that CHN is able to really uphold its commitments to partner organizations. Pardon me. Alrighty. So we are going to start with a transitional statewide leadership team, which we are currently in the process of building as we speak. And we were going to quickly, so Ashley mentioned earlier that we, Xuan Chang and Noma Ojiaku, sorry, I need to have a drink of water,
yeah,
are both going to be members of our transitional statewide leadership team. And we'll have more announcements coming soon. And we were just going to say, Xuan and Noma, do you want to just hop off mute and say hi?
And if you want, to share why you're jumping in with us, that would be great too, in a minute or so, if you want.
No pressure.
Sure. No, it's been really great to be able to help with this organization. And, since we're also, I'm also doing the fellowship with Cindy and C, I felt like it was a really good way to be able to kind of coincide those efforts together as we're trying to build the bones of this organization. I have a good amount of experience building organizations, and so I figured I could help.
Awesome. Yeah, and Xuan is talking about the Climate Health Organizing Fellowship that Peja and Galbraith at the Cambridge Health Alliance are putting together, which is an amazing resource. So it's all weaving together. And then Noma, do you want to say hi and maybe what motivated you or why you're joining?
Sure. Hello again. So yes, I am really excited to be joining you guys. I was inspired by the initiative that both Ashley and Amanda took in taking this issue that affects us as a community, personally, our families, and then being able to translate that into action. So you guys did inspire me to get involved. I've been getting more increasingly involved in the climate health and health space through the Medical Society Consortium has a fellowship program for those who are interested in climate health, human health, and its relationship to equity. So that's kind of my background and kind of the part of the impetus to participate. But I am looking forward to the upcoming year.
Excellent. Yeah. And again, these connections are really cool because, I think most of you know, but Climate Health Now is a state level affiliate for the Medical Society Consortium on Climate and Health. So we're, all these circles are starting to overlap more and more, build our power. So we're elated to have both of you to be building this up together. So
And you want to this one? Oh, this is me. So the next part that we're gonna, part of our structure that's gonna help us achieve our strategy is the advocacy advisory team. And you know, I mentioned this partially, but to go a little bit greater in detail. So these will be not CHN members. They will be California leaders in environmental justice, climate, and in community groups who really are like the policy experts. So we're outsourcing that because, you know, we don't need to have that. And there's plenty of experts that we can learn from and lean on in this realm. But we're gonna ask them to commit to, I think, 1 or 2 year terms. And we're going to ask them probably in January to basically make a slate of where they think, you know, it would be most impactful for Climate Health Now's medicinal dynamite to be used. And then our leadership team will, you know, look at that list, see what we can do. And that will be what, you know, they really make recommendations for how we can contribute to the overall landscape. Any questions on that part? Good. Okay. Great. Back to Amanda.
Okay. So we are going to just talk in a little bit more depth about the resource team. So our vision is to start with 2 different resource teams that any CHN member is welcome to join and be a part of. Eventually, each team will have a coordinator, and eventually each team will have a representative that is part of a statewide leadership team. That won't be true right at the get-go because of how things need to go in terms of getting structure in place, but eventually everyone will have a voice on the leadership team as well. So what do these teams do? So resource teams will provide support for organizational functions and expertise on a variety of different issues that are defined by the leadership team. We will be starting with what we're calling, at least right now, CHN Speaks as a resource team, and then healthcare decarbonization as a resource team. So CHN Speaks, we will focus on probably a lot of different issues, but the primary one being, how do we have members of CHN ready to go in terms of being able to talk to colleagues, talk to the media, talk to their communities about issues related to climate health and equity. So one of the number one questions we get asked right now, especially from new members, is I want to give a talk at my, you know, hospital or my community group. Do you have slides that I can use? And the answer has always been, well, sort of, but they're very piecemeal. So we want the answer to that to be yes, and here's how you can use them, and here's how we can help you. Another area that is of really strong interest to many, many of us is the issue of healthcare decarbonization itself. As Ashley mentioned at the outset, we know that healthcare as an industry is part of the problem with why we have climate change, where 8 to 10% of emissions, depending on who's ourselves. And so we will also have a resource team working on healthcare decarbonization. So I forget specifically who it was at the beginning who said that they're working on their institution to sign on to the HHS pledge, which is awesome. And then how can we as a community support people in making those sorts of asks? What information do members need in order to go to their, you know, that's a pretty daunting task to just go to your institution and ask for them to sign on to something. So what resources do we need to make people more comfortable with that and to make them more successful? And so, the, you know, how, oh yeah.
Jeff, we're hoping you're going to be really excited about that resource team.
Yes,
by the way, among others.
So the question of how do these teams contribute to our overall strategic vision is really in three different ways at this point. base building. So how do we bring more members of the health community into climate health advocacy, education, both of ourselves and of the, you know, institutions of which we are a part, and recruitment of new members. And then eventually really having these resource teams be the ones who are providing members with tools that we need in order to achieve our goals.
And I would just add one other thing to the goal of speaking to our colleagues. You know, it's not the talks that we're wanting to help each other give are not just your regular CME talks about, like, this is a litany of the ways that climate change is a health risk multiplier. These talks are different because our goal is to recruit everybody listening to become a member. And so that's where, like, the community organizing and, you know, our health backgrounds are intersecting. Is this isn't just your standard CME, this is your standard CME of, like, our lives are on the line, our kids' lives are on the line. This is not just for education, this is for building our base of members who are ready to take action together. And that's what makes it really fun and a little different. So we need to help each other with that.
Yeah, there's a call to action involved. Yeah.
And Pedge is gonna help us do that really well. okay, and then this part is also really exciting. So in terms of the local, this is your
yeah.
slide.
Okay, yeah. So in terms of how, and I know we know this is kind of a lot of information coming, and we will have much more to come in the future, but this, so how will local hubs work? So what we're going to start with is trying to launch two local hubs in most likely the next year or so, and there will be a lot of decision making around how we'll make those decisions about which teams to formally launch. But what we are building toward is that we're taking action at the state level, but it's really still all about what's going on locally, in terms of who the relationships that we have and the ways that we can influence and talk to our elected officials who are assembly people, our state senators. So this is where having one of many reasons why having a local hub is really valuable. So essentially one of the things these local hubs will do is engage and think really strategically and in partnership with other groups about how to engage at the local level to achieve statewide goals. So for example, Ashley just this morning actually spoke at a press conference on Proposition 30, which is a proposition that has a huge coalition backing it, that would both help mitigate wildfires and help get electric vehicles into the hands of low-income communities throughout the state. So for, you know, I'm just sort of thinking this out loud, but one way, and, you know, there's a proposition works a little bit differently because it's voters, not necessarily elected officials who are voting on the ballot, but think, you know, there are parts of the state, as you can imagine, where this proposition may be much more opposed than in other parts of the state. So how could we engage a local hub to really help potentially achieve success in specific parts of the state? Mm-hmm. So that's where we're headed with the local hubs. And then just to give it a little bit finer detail, each local hub eventually will have four leadership positions. So there will be a coordinator. There will also be a statewide leadership team representative, so that there's always a connection between the local hub and the statewide leadership team. A member coach, so someone whose job, you know, whose role is really to work one-on-one with members about, for example, you know, how do you engage in a legislative advocacy meeting, or how do you speak at a press conference? All of these sorts of things that we want our, you know, hope our members will be doing. And then a recruitment coach. How do we grow the hub and make sure that we're bringing in a wide variety of voices?
And we just have a couple more slides and then we'll go back to the Google form to get your feedback there if you want. And then we'll also have time for discussion. So so we need to make CHNs work somebody's day job because right now it's, you know, catch as catch can and it's really not sustainable. So we're in this startup phase we're on the cusp of making this a sustainable organization that's going to be around for decades, just like our PSR colleagues. So in order to do that, we need to resource it. And the way we're going to do that is with actually three staff positions, and we have job descriptions, y'all. We're ready for this. So the three, I like this, this graphic, right? Let me go back one. There we go. So this graphic shows what we're hoping in terms of our three staff roles, that the goal is to start next summer, maybe next May or June. So the one role, and they're all in kind of a co-director model where really we're building a non-hierarchical democratic organization here. So one will be the operations director, which will be Amanda is slated in for this. We're going to fund this. Right. Operations director, I'm going to have the opportunity and growth experience of strategic director. And then the third staff member, who we don't think we know yet, but we're going to be recruiting for soon, is a community organizing director. So these are the three, you know, legs of the stool that's going to make our organization really, really strong. And the staff will be really in a supportive role to make all the other pieces kind of run smoothly. And, you know, understanding that we all have really busy lives, a lot of our lives, you know, change a lot, but the staff will be the kind of through line through all of the different work and help to fill the gaps where our members, where they need it in order to be effective together. And okay, so that's that. And then this is the part where if we were a, you know, faith organization, we would be passing a hat. So it's getting real. And you all know that CHN is a labor of love. We're a nonprofit. We have raised a lot of money, actually. So we have about $64,000 and we need to get to $36,000 before we start. 36,000 more before we start circulating the job description that we have for a community organizing director. So we are always accepting tax deductible donations, and I'm gonna put myself out there with a vulnerability chip. If anybody would be willing to pitch in today, like $20 using, we have this easy to access QR code, but we really do want and need to rely on our members to pitch in and support us. Because the more member supported we are, the truer we can be to exactly what our mission is. And if we have to rely on, you know, other funders, especially grants, that often comes with a fair bit of strings attached that can, you know, really get in the way of just doing the work that we know needs to be done. So would anybody be willing to raise your hand if you could pitch in like $20 today? Because that would help us a lot. Any hands going up? Okay. Well, we're here and we appreciate it a lot. Thank you, Hina. Woo-hoo! Thank you. Hopefully it's a really easy process and we really, really appreciate it. So thank you, Hina. I appreciate that a lot. And yours truly, oh, thank you. I see that more folks are raising. So thank you. So yours truly has not ever been a fundraiser, but that's what I'm going to do because I could not believe more in the work we're doing. And so I'm going to become a fundraiser and because it just has to happen, right? So Amanda's going to finish with the last slide on the structural pieces, and then it'll really just be discussion and save the dates.
Yes, Kate, we can put the QR code back up. There's also a link in the chat, and thank you all. I think I can honestly say fundraising is really hard and does not come naturally. I think I could fill a book with all of the things that I want to learn that I didn't learn in my training, and fundraising would for sure be one of them, many. And that's the QR code again. And I was just gonna share really quickly, and we, without going into too much detail here, what the role of, so CHN currently has an advisory council that's been in existence for about 9 months, that's 7 members. And under our new organizational structure, we'll really be transitioning to an advisory council that is smaller and also much more specifically aligned with the role of the 3 staff members. So the idea is that for each of the managing directors, there will be a specific advisory council member who is that person's essentially coach. There's an organization that we read a lot about and going through this process that refers the people in these roles as the OWLs, which I found really compelling, the idea that they're sort of looking out and observers and accumulators of lots of different information, and then are helping the directors really make forward progress and move through the work. So that's what that will look like. And that will be to come.
Yeah. So again, you know, we built in about 5 minutes here where we could have discussion, questions, clarifications, ideas. And if you are more extrovert and you want to talk about those questions, or if you're more introvert and you want to put it into the Google form, we will carefully review that. And thanks for joining, Padja.
And I just put the link again to the Google form in. So if there are questions, if anything, like donations, Kate, are tax deductible. Yes, the donations are through our 501c3 fiscal sponsor, so they are tax deductible.
Yeah. And you'll get this, our fiscal sponsor is awesome and they do really good work, but their name is a little awkward, and it's the Oil and Gas Action Network. So when that pops up in your receipt, don't be alarmed. It's legit. There are people, but that's their name. Here's the donation. Yeah, any questions? What do y'all think? How is it sounding? What teams do you feel most called to be a part of? Thank you, Lauren. Glad to see you. Lauren, my sense would be you might be kind of called to the healthcare decarb resource team. Is that Phil?
Maybe. I mean, I like the idea of trying to get more of my colleagues involved as well. And I'm hoping that will take off some. I like the idea of trying to get more patient education and messaging in day-to-day patient visits, which doesn't so much apply to me as an ENT surgeon, but I want to see if I can engage my primary care and pediatric colleagues in those things.
Yeah,
definitely. So I'm hopeful that I can help others in my institution to pile on. Yeah.
Lauren, are you a pediatric ENT or?
So I'm a general ENT but I do more thyroid and parathyroid as well as pedi.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, cool. Okay.
And a special shout out, Hannah, is it right that you gave a talk today to some colleagues?
I'm sorry, to me?
Sorry.
Hannah. Okay. I just want to say hi to Hannah.
Hi, sorry. I'm about to run to clinic, but yes, I did. I spoke at the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee meeting, and it was a very brief talk, but I'm just trying to get folks recruited to participate in more sustainability stuff for my organization. And then next week, I will be part of, I just got the invite, Environmental Committee something. So I'll learn more about that and hopefully find ways to get more involved. Yep.
So cool. Big high five. That's really, really exciting.
Thank you.
And the goal is that the CHN Speaks team will really be, a resource for all of us to do exactly what Hannah is doing. So wonderful. Awesome. Did I see anybody else want to kind of say hi or any comments or anything? Okay. Okay. Well, please do finish the Go ahead, Jeff.
Hey, I think it's great that we are focusing on state legislation, because as we've seen in the last couple of weeks, it's so important, so critical, and California needs to lead the country and the world in this. So I think it's great that we're doing that, and I'm excited to help out any way I can.
You kind of save the dates. I'll just go through this super quickly. What's coming up next? So launching the transitional leadership team. So stay tuned for that. Thinking about really building our teams. So thinking strategically about which local hubs to launch, recruiting for the resource teams, putting together, lots and lots of building to come. And we will have our next monthly community meeting coming up in October. Mm-hmm. And I will put the link to register for that in the chat in 1 second.
And I'm gonna do a special shout out, because I am really bummed that this is physician and medical student specific, which the exclusivity is not the goal at all, but it is something. It's forward movement, at least. So many of you know I'm involved in the California Medical Association and trying to move them towards using their lobby influence for climate action and health equity. So if Amanda could drop in the chat, all physicians and medical students in California are really warmly welcomed to what we're calling the Climate Health and Equity Symposium. So this is a different symposium in October, but it's going to have a really incredible lineup. We have our California Department of Public Health. So Dan's boss, I think, Dr. Rohan Radhakrishna, he's in charge of the Office of Health Equity, and he's talking about the climate action imperative to achieve health equity. We're gonna have Assembly Member Luz Rivas from LA is speaking. We have Dr. Lisa Patel speaking. We're gonna have somebody named Walt Vernon, who's part of Mazzetti, which is a consulting group that's part of the National Academy of Medicine Healthcare Decarbonization Collaborative. And they're gonna be talking about what does it mean to do an emissions inventory of a healthcare system, and how do you do that, and how they help us. And we will also have Deborah Gorman, who's the CEO and president of Greenlining, that does awesome policy work. And we will also have Jason Vargo, who is an economist. He works at the Federal Reserve, but he studies the healthcare costs of climate change. So it's really gonna be an engaging conversation. And the goal is to have 100 people in the room in LA and 200 of our friends, that's you, joining virtually. So it's a hybrid event from 2 to 4 on Friday, October 21st. And the more of us who show up, participate in this event, whether in person or virtual, it's really going to send a really important message to the CMA leadership, so that we can get those lobbyists they have in Sacramento talking about climate. And so please share the word. It is for physicians, which is limited, but share it with all the physicians please, and medical students too.
Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to underscore again the fact that CMA has not ever had an event like this before that has the words climate change in its title. So I think they are excited about it, but also this is sort of a test to see how much engagement there is on this topic. So again, we want to send the message that this is really important to physicians in California, medical students. So super, it's exciting and a real chance to prove to them that this is really important.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Great. And then we have a few other awesome things that are coming up. So Thursday, the 29th in the evening. So Thursday evening, the Medical Society Consortium on Climate and Health, one of their consultants called Burnett is a media company. And they're going to be offering us a workshop about climate and health and media and how we speak to the media in really effective ways. And it will be anybody from California can join. And actually Nevada also. So if you have any friends in Nevada, they can join. But that's something that I'm definitely going to be a part of, and I hope you will join. The Friday the 23rd, so from 12 to 6 in the afternoon, our dear friend and ally, most of you know Lisa Patel, and actually UC Davis is organizing it this year. So the NorCal Symposium on Climate, Health, and Equity. That's going to be really fun. They have a great lineup. CHN is offering a happy hour from 5 to 6, so that'll be fun. It's really, you know, don't want to miss that because it's great. And then we already mentioned the October 21st event for the CMA co-sponsored event. And lastly, we'll be back with our people on October 19th for our community meeting. And there'll be a lot of communications between then, but that's what we have. Okay, for real last thing. So how to keep joining, you know, inviting more members. So again, all health community people in California are welcome to join us. And they can just go to our website, climatehealthnow.org. And there's a really easy join us button. Shuin did a makeover of our website. I don't know if you all noticed that, but it looks so good. So you can send them there and invite them to join the movement. And that's about it. Thank you all for sharing your lunch hour with us.
I'm sorry we kept you 2 minutes late, but thank you all for joining. Yeah, stay safe, stay healthy.
We'll be in touch. Thank you.